Hi everyone and welcome to Conspectus. Today's topic of discussion is sperm morphology. I'm Dr. Keshav Malhotra. I'm the director of Rainbow IVF and also the director of META, which is Malhotra Embryology Training Academy. And you can get in touch with me at metaembryology@gmail.com. Let's begin. So sperm morphology is, I think, one of the most important parameters as far as the selection of a sperm is concerned. We are talking about the factors which are responsible for fertilization, and sperm morphology does play a major role as far as the fertilization process itself is also concerned. Like in the last lecture, we were discussing about sperm motility, where motility is also one of the important parameters to be considered. Morphology, so if a sperm is motile and is morphologically abnormal or doesn't have an acrosome or such features are present which can prevent fertilization, then obviously we're not going to get the best kind of outcome, and that's where morphology comes and plays a role. So before we head into the details of sperm morphology, let's first understand what a basic normal sperm looks like. So a normal sperm is oval in shape. The head is oval in shape, which you can see that the length of the head is about 4 to 5 microns. The width is about 2.5 to 3.5 microns. It should have a well-defined acrosome. So the lighter area that you see here, that's the acrosome. Then again, it should have a nice nucleus. Followed up, so the tail should be attached axially to the head. So it should be right in the center. You should have a nice mid-piece or a well-defined mid-piece. And then a tail which is about 45 to 50 microns in length. And this should be thinner than the mid-piece. Right, so this is the basic morphological structures of the sperm. Now we know that morphology is on the decline. The newer standards which are set by WHO in 2010 basically state that the cutoff for normal morphology now is more than 4%. So any sample which has more than 4% of morphology is classified as normal. These are the lower fifth percentile of several combined studies of so-called fertile men, where they found out that the men who had a morphology of less than 4% took a longer time in conceiving, apart from men who had a morphology of more than 4%. So that's how they basically tabulated the morphology percentages. Now, morphology does have an effect on embryonic development. Normally, what we think is that the sperm starts contributing to the embryonic development after it crosses the 8-cell stage, or when the paternal genome basically switches on. And that is where we basically think that morphology starts playing a role, but that's not true. It has been shown that morphology starts to play a role right from the fertilization process itself towards all throughout embryonic development and even to embryonic implantation, etc. So we now divide morphological disorders into two kinds: organoid defects and nuclear defects. So let's talk about organoid defects. Now, organoid defects are basically membranal defects or defects in the cytosolic factors, which are basically responsible for oocyte activation. So if there is a membrane defect or if there is a centrosome defect, these would actually come into the organoid defect category. And what it does is that it will affect the early embryonic developmental stages. So right from the fertilization itself, so the formation of the pronucleuses, towards the first and second cleavage, those are the ones which are going to be affected because of the organoid defects. And then you have something which is known as nuclear defects, where you have basically disorders of the sperm nucleus. So again, this is inside the sperm head where the nucleus will not be present, or the nucleus will be deficient, and these are the ones which are going to affect the later stages of embryonic development, like the third cleavage, fourth cleavage, blastulation, etc. They could be responsible for affecting late development stages as well, so can cause miscarriages, can cause abortions. So these are the things that we need to consider as far as the sperm morphology is concerned. So whenever you have a patient who's having these problems, like who's having errors of embryonic development or who's facing miscarriages even with normal conception, it is very, very important to analyze the male partner as well. because most of the times we only keep focusing on the female parameters, we only keep focusing on the egg, and we don't really look for these subtle changes which are actually evident on the semen analysis and sperm morphology analysis. So these are the things that we need to now start considering to improve our practices. There are multiple sperm defects which can be seen when you do a morphology stain, right? I've already talked to you how a normal sperm looks like. Now, any deviation from that normal can be classified as abnormal, and there can be multiple defects. Like, there can be disorders of the head. So you can have a pyriform head, you can have a tapered head, you can have vacuoles inside the head, you can have a microcephalic head or a macrocephalic head, which is a small head or a large head. You can have disorders of the tail, where you can have two tails, three tails, coil tails, etc. You can have disorders of the midpiece and the neck, where you can have a bent midpiece, you can have a thick midpiece. So these are quite a lot of defects which can be seen when you do a morphological assessment. Now, the way of doing a morphological assessment is basically by staining. And once you stain the slide, you visualize it under oil immersion. So you take a 100x lens and you visualize those sperms under oil immersion, and that is where you will start looking at certain disorders. So you will start, so you can actually see that, okay, probably this is a large head. When you compare it to a normal head, you can see acrosomal defects if they're not classifying, if they're not falling into the category of more than 40% or between 40 to 70%, then you will classify it as an acrosomal defect. Like, look at this sperm, does not even have an acrosome. Here you can see multiple heads with coiling of the tail as well, so that can be visualized. Very important to differentiate whether there are two sperms in the same plane or whether they are actually defects. So that also has to be differentiated. Globozoospermia is basically when you will not have an acrosome and it will have like a round head. So that's globozoospermia. I have another slide of it, but main way of differentiating it is by electron microscopy. But you can also get hints about globozoospermia on sperm morphology analysis as well. It's a very rare disorder. It classifies it to, it happens only to less than 0.1% of the patients that you see in your clinic. We've been fortunate enough to get two cases in the last 5 years, so that's our data. But globozoospermia is also categorized into two categories. It can be complete globozoospermia, where you'll have a completely round head, 100% round head with a complete absence of the acrosome. This is mainly because of the genetic causes. And then you can have partial globozoospermia, which categorizes about 20 to 60% of the cases or of the sperms will have round heads and can be attributed to environmental causes. Now, the main features, like I mentioned, is a rounded head or a round nucleus, absence of an acrosome, absence of the post-acrosomal sheath. Now, this is very important because this contains all the factors which are responsible for oocyte activation. Now, because the acrosome and the acrosomal sheath are absent, even if you do ICSI in such cases, there might be a lack of fertilization, or you can still have total fertilization failure in such cases. And that is why in such cases, it has been advised that you use artificial oocyte activation, so that you don't have a total fertilization failure. You can also, in certain cases, get a disturbed midpiece and a coiled tail along with this condition. So this is a little bit about globozoospermia and a little bit about sperm morphology. Obviously, we're going to talk in more detail about morphology in the online lecture series that we are producing. But again, if you have any questions regarding sperm morphology, do get in touch with me on my email ID, metaembryology@gmail.com. And follow this series about sperm parameters. The next series is going to be on oocyte factors. So follow it up and shoot me your questions, shoot me your queries, and I will be very, very happy to create more videos on them or actually reply to you personally. And I hope you're enjoying this series, and I hope you continue watching. Thanks.